Welcome, everyone. My name is Chrissi Kelly, and I am from Absent. And today I have the pleasure of introducing you to Dr. Cho, who's just put out a paper on the use of gabapentin for patients who have severe parosmia. So welcome, Dr. Cho. Would you like to just give us a little bit of information about yourself and what your affiliation is in the United States?
Yes. Oh, okay. Hello. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me here today. My name is Do-Yeon Cho. You can just call me Do. It's my great honor to be here. I'm currently in Birmingham in the United States, another Birmingham, and I'm currently the associate professor at the University of Alabama at Birmingham in ENT department. And I'm currently, mostly I do sinus, I'm a rhinologist there and here. And then I also do sinus surgeries. I do 50% the research about why the sinusitis is happening in the patients.
I see. And have you seen a lot of patients with smell loss during the pandemic period?
Yes, I did. Because of the, in Alabama, because of the living in the South, there are low rates of vaccinations and people had a lot of COVID and a lot of patients are suffering from the hyposmia or smell loss or dysosmia from this COVID. So that was the main reason that I decided to study more about the smell loss initially. Yes.
And how did your hypothesis about the use for gabapentin arise? Mm-hmm. What made you think that this might be a good treatment for people with severe parosmia?
It was kind of an anecdotal experience. Main reason is that I've seen a lot of patients with the smell loss. And initially I thought because people saying that, oh, parosmia could be kind of signs of recovery. So initially I give all my patients who actually have parosmia, give a kind of assurance that your smell is going to come back. But I've seen certain group of patients, they actually having a lot of weight loss and they can't eat anything. It's more of a life-threatening than regular other smell dysfunction. So I decided I need to do something about this patient. Maybe it could be I should be admit this patient, give like two feeding or something because their symptoms are so severe. So, and then one of the patients came to say, oh, I started taking this medication. And then she said, I feel really good. Oh, my bad smells went away. I said, like, really? Then what was it? Oh, it was gabapentin. Oh, really? How much are you taking? That's kind of like started, that was happened like, it's not very long. It's been maybe about a year ago that one patient came in and said, oh, sometime I have a neurologic pain. I started taking gabapentin. And actually, oh, my smells made better. That was kind of, and then I reviewed the articles and there's a lot of case reports in 2000, early 2010s and 11s, that there's some anecdotal case reports about the valproic acids or gabapentin or pregabalin, that all these kind of neurologic medication can improve symptoms of parosmia. So that's why, okay. And then the gabapentin is relatively very safe medication. So we've been seeing a lot of patients with chronic cough in our department by the world expert, you know, the laryngologist. So that was kind of idea that, okay, let's start as lower dose and see how that everybody respond. That's how everything started.
So you're saying that patients that were prescribed gabapentin for another condition were
right.
suddenly coming to you and saying, this is actually working on my parosmia, or it feels like it's working on my parosmia.
Exactly. That's okay. How I started. And then I went over the literature, whether I have any evidence there, and then there was. So that's what I, okay. And then I went to all the review papers from the other after COVID, but no one actually mentioned any single lines about parosmia and about using the gabapentin. But all the literatures I get able to get it was like before the pandemic. And they said, oh, there's some clue here that we probably can prescribe these medications.
Right. And you, as I think I heard you say that gabapentin is generally well tolerated. What kind of secondary effects does it have on the body? Or are that, you know, how would you describe that to a patient if you were going to offer them the medication and then prepare them for any side effects?
Yes. Usually, gabapentin is usually prescribed for in our field in ENTs, but perioperative pain or chronic cough, and a major side effect I explained to patients about possible there's insomnia. I mean, sorry, the sleepiness, like you feel very sleepy and tired and somnolence during the day. Those kind of things that if you feel really tired, you can't to work because you have a pentin that you have to stop and reduce the dose. That's the major things. Yes. So in this, my case series that they're only of those patients who I prescribe, two patients drop it out because of those 11 patients I prescribe, two patients drop it out because there's some side effect from that.
So, can you tell me how many patients did you look at when you did this study on gabapentin?
Yes. So I went over the patients between 2000, that was between August 2021 to February 2022. So that was about, I went over all the 6 months patients who visited only my clinic. There are three rhinologists in our group, but I didn't go over the other providers' data. That's only for that's only for 6 months of my patients who actually visited my clinic. And there are a total of 85 patients I've been seeing for major, as a new patient, not the follow-up, as a new patient with a smell loss in my clinic. And then I was able to identify there were 14 patients actually had the major complaint, the parosmia, was the major symptoms. The prevalence about like 16.7%. I'm not including any patients say there's major smells. Oh yeah, here and there I have some little bit foul smells. I just don't include those patients as a major symptoms. About roughly about 16% of patients complain about parosmia, severe parosmia in my clinic.
So what were your findings? How did you find that people were responding to gabapentin if they had severe parosmia?
My finding was that we were able to analyze 9 patients who were actually given gabapentin, and there were significant improvements in roughly about two-thirds, 66% of patients had a significant improvement after taking gabapentin. So this is more of a case series of retrospective analysis. Definitely based on this finding, we need a randomized control study to prove its efficacy